Welcome everyone to the Integrability Journal Club. And this week we are very happy to have Charlotte Kristjansen from the NBI. She will tell us about overlapped and fermionic dualities for integrable superspin chains. Please, Charlotte.
Okay, thank you. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for setting up this nice journal club. I think it works extremely well. And then of course, I also want to thank them for inviting me to speak here and to thank all of you who tuned in to my talk. So I will talk about overlaps and fermionic dualities for integrable super spin chains. And all of these concepts are interesting in their own right, but I will try to argue that ADS-CFT somehow begs us to tie them together. And the work that I will present was done in collaboration with Dennis Müller and Konstantin Zarembo and appeared in these two papers, but there will also be some work in progress which involves the same persons and also some two young students from NBI. Okay. So as I said, the three concepts in the title, they are interesting in their own right, but we also have a motivating for studying them from ADS-CFT. We know that there's an integrable PSU2,2/4 super spin chain, which underlies ADS-CFT correspondence. The single trace operators of the field theory get identified with beta eigenstates of the spin chain, and the corresponding eigenvalues become the conformal dimensions of the operators, as we know. The overlaps between eigenstates and certain boundary states also appear within ADS-CFT. The boundary states, they represent a domain wall on the field theory side or a probe brain on the string theory side. And the overlaps are also important in the study of quantum quenches and statistical mechanics. So that was the two first concepts. And then how do fermionic dualities enter the picture? Well, the fermionic dualities, they allow you to move between different Dynkin diagrams of a super Lie algebra. And simply speaking, fermionic dualities, they are changes of variables in the beta equations, which effectively change the Dynkin diagram of the underlying Lie algebra. And these dualities allow us to translate overlap formulas from one Dynkin diagram to another and allow for comparison of results that are obtained using different Dynkin diagrams to represent the Lie algebra. And our hope is also that by studying these fermionic dualities, we can maybe constrain the overlap formulas of relevance for ADS-CFT. Okay, so I will start this talk by reviewing what we have of integrable overlaps within the ADS-CFT correspondence. And then I'll turn to discussing what is the general structure of overlap formulas that we have found. After that, I'll turn to discussing the fermionic dualities. And my aim with doing so is to find a way to translate my overlap formulas between different Dynkin diagrams of the super Lie algebra. And I will finish by listing some possible future applications of what we've been doing. Okay, so first of all, by an overlap, I mean an inner product between a beta eigenstate and some boundary state. And we say that such an overlap is integrable if it's computable in closed form for any eigenvalue of the spin chain, eigenvector of the spin chain. And within ADS-CFT, the boundary state, it will, as I said, typically represent a domain wall on the field theory side or a probe brain on the string theory side. And we have met two types of boundary states which have led to integrable overlaps. So one type of such boundary state is what is known as a matrix product state. It's a state which takes this form where you sum over all spin states on the spin chain, and the prefactor of each spin state is a trace of a certain product of matrices where there's one matrix associated with each spin possible spin chain state of the chain. There's another type of integrable boundary state that we have met within ADS-CFT, and that's known as a valence bond state or a two-side product state. It's a state that one gets by taking a direct product of a large number of two-side states, and it could be any type of two-side state. So the sum of all possible two-side states with appropriate prefixes. So we have also understood what it means or when we can characterize such a boundary state as integrable. We have understood the integrability of the boundary state in a scattering picture. And we have understood how to formulate a requirement in the scattering language that the boundary state is integrable. And basically it means that the boundary state must consist of an entangled pair of excitations with momentum, pairs of excitations with momentum plus and minus p. And that's we can formulate by the requirement that all the odd charges of the spin chain annihilate the boundary state. Okay. So.
Sorry, Charlotte. The odd charges, so the local charges are not part of that.
These are all local charges of the spin
all
chain.
All local charges.
Yes, all local odd charges. So the odd charges are basically have eigenvalues which are.
Sorry, I phrased it slightly badly. The Lie algebra charges, which are those.
I mean, these are just the local charges of the spin chain.
I mean, like if I had an SU2 spin chain, I just meant. The SU2 generated charges are part of this, or?
Yes, for SU2, it would be the momentum would be the first odd charge. Then you would have a third odd charge. I mean, these are the tower of conserved charges in the.
Yeah, that these are conserved current associated charge quantities that you should annihilate this special state.
Yes, but the SU2 subalgebra is. Well, are you saying that all the SU2 charges have to annihilate, or all the SU2 generators have to annihilate the boundary state?
I'm speaking in the spin chain language, where the spin chain's integrability is expressed in terms of conservation of conserved charges. And these charges can be split into odd and even charges, and all the odd charges have to annihilate the boundary state.
And so you know when you have an SU2, the spin, the total spin, is one of those charges or not?
Well, the first one is the momentum, and then comes the Hamiltonian. Then there's some charge which involves three neighboring spin sites, and so on.
Implicitly,
but I guess these are the conserved charges that, which you're getting from expanding the transfer matrix, right?
Exactly.
And but the transfer matrix doesn't give you the global spin in the z direction. You need to include this by hand. So I guess the global spin would not be one of these charges.
I guess not.
Yeah, so really what I was trying to ask is, in you know, if these boundary states sit in ADS-CFT, they would also be annihilated by half of the supercharges typically, but this is not part of that.
Oh, equation. Yes, okay, that's another question. In the specific setup that I will consider, it will also be annihilated by half of the supercharges.
But that's not this equation.
No, it's not these
charges. Okay. Thanks.
Sorry about that. I'm only in the spin language now. Okay, so this is what the defect setup looks like, where these boundary states become of relevance. So it's a setup where on the gauge theory side, one has introduced a domain wall that separates two regions of space-time with a different rank of the gauge group, namely un and un minus k. And correspondingly on the string theory side, we have k of the D3 brains that constitute the normal background being dissolved in a D5 brain. And the boundary state somehow represents this domain wall, respectively probe brain on the string theory side. So the way in which the gauge group is broken across the domain wall is by some of the scalar fields attaining a non-vanishing classical value on the right hand side on the defect. So there is a codimension one defect. And more specifically, the classical values look like this, where you have an n by n matrix, which is in the upper left hand corner, has a matrix of size k times k, where these three matrices constitute a k-dimensional irreducible representation of issue two. So such a classical field is compatible with the equations of classical equation of motions of n equals 4 super Young Mills, and the solution is conserves half of the supercharges of the full setup. That's what was asked before. Any questions about that? So you should also notice there's some dependence on this distance from the defect here as 1 or x3. Okay, so now in this defect setup, if one wants to do perturbative computations, one has to expand around this classical vacuum, at least on the right-hand side of the defect. And to do that, it's convenient to expand the quantum fields or to divide the quantum fields into different parts with a k times k block in the upper left-hand corner like this. And then the behavior of these various quantum fields are slightly different. And one has to distinguish between two different cases, namely the case where the dimension of the representation is larger than one and the more trivial case where it's equal to one. If k is larger than one, then when you do the expansion around the classical fields, then you find that all the field components in the upper block rectangle here and the left-hand rectangle, they become massive. And they have masses in quotation marks, which behave as 1 or x3 squared, where x3 was the distance from the defect. And this effectively means that these fields have ADS propagators, and you have to do perturbative calculations in an ADS space. I should say, fortunately, the gauge field does not get a mass. But all the fields in the big part of the matrix here, they remain massless. If k is equal to one, then the situation is a little bit different. There's no classical field, but the fields, they get specific boundary conditions exactly at the defect. The big chunk of the matrix fields do not get boundary conditions, but again, these rectangles at the top and then the left-hand side, they get specific boundary conditions either or Neumann in such a way that the supersymmetry, half of the supersymmetries are again preserved. Okay. So it's in these defect setups that the overlap of the spin chain become important. So of course, when you have a defect, it's possible to have one-point functions in your conformal field theory. And as usual, correlation functions are completely determined by the symmetries, and a one-point function of an operator, conformal operator with dimension delta, is found to take this form here, where x3 is the distance from the defect and delta is the conformal dimension, and c is some structure constant that one has to compute, either perturbatively or by some other, in some other way. So now, if we consider this defect setup that I just described, and we take the dimension of this representation of the classical fields to be larger than zero, then it's clear that all the operators built from scalars that can have non-zero one-point functions already at tree level. And we find these by taking our operator and replacing each field by its classical value. Of course, we know that a good conformal operator is a complicated linear combination of single trace operators, and we find them by means of integrability. Now to actually compute this one-point function is where we make use of the matrix product state. So the matrix product state, as I said, it's a sum over all states of our spin chain that represents our operator. And each spin chain state has a certain matrix associated with it. In this matrix product state, we sum over all states, and the coefficient of a given state is equal to the trace of the product of corresponding representation matrices. And the reason why we introduce that is that then we can formulate the computation of the one-point function in this way here. We simply have to calculate the overlap between the matrix product state and the Bethe eigenstate. Because what this inner product does is to pick out from the Bethe eigenstate the terms which have the same, have a particular combination of the scalar fields, and then it replaces that with the trace of the corresponding representation matrices, and that's exactly what we have to do to compute the one-point function. And then if we want to normalize everything correctly, we should also divide by the norm of the Bethe eigenstate. Okay. And now if we instead look at the k equals one case, oops, then we have to compute the one-point function by honest field theoretical contractions. And therefore I have written down here what the contraction rules are for k equals one. And one can write the contraction rules in a simple manner if one introduces a propagator which looks like this and depends on a parameter kappa, which is equal to one for Neumann boundary conditions, minus one for Dirichlet, and zero for no boundary conditions. Then the propagator takes this general form depending on the various boundary conditions. And here it's important that there's an X bar appearing, which is equal to X with the third component, the one perpendicular to the defect, replaced by minus X3. Then you form your complex scalars of N equals four super young Mills by combining a scalar field with a Neumann boundary condition with one with a Dirichlet boundary condition. And in that way, you get some interesting possibility of contracting two identical fields. Namely, if you take a contraction of two identical complex scalars X, you actually get something which is non-vanishing and non-singular. If you take a field component from this upper rectangular block, or just the first line for one of the fields, and from the first column for the other field. So what you get is a difference between a Neumann and a Dirichlet propagator, and it gives you a term which looks like that, which you see is non-vanishing and non-singular, even if the two complex scalars are identical. And it's non-singular when x goes to y because it turns into 1 over 2x3 in the denominator. You can also calculate the other propagators which are needed for n equals 4 super young Mills. For instance, the propagators for the two fermionic fields which appear in the SU2/3 sector. And in that case, you have some flavor indices, alpha and beta, and again, color indices of which one component of each field has to be one. And it gives you the usual delta function contraction for matrix fields. And then you get also an epsilon alpha beta for the flavor indices and some space-time dependence, which is as you expect for fermions in four dimensions. But again, it's something which is non-vanishing and non-singular when x goes to y. So to compute one-point functions at the lowest possible orders, you have to contract pairs of fields following these rules. And as we know, in the large N limit, we have to contract neighboring fields. But for this case, it was one case, there's one additional rule, which is illustrated on these figures here. Namely, the ring here, it represents a single trace operator, and each endpoint of two fields here is where the fields are, they represent the fields inside the single trace operator. So we have an additional rule here that the index one has to run in the outer ring here, and the free index A, it has to run in the interior of these small loops. In this way, we get the maximal power of N. So the diagrams which contribute in the large N limit are of this type here to the left, whereas diagrams which look as on the right, they're subleading at large N. And you see that this is where the other type of boundary states come into play. Namely, to compute correlation functions of this type, we have to compute the overlap between a Bethe eigenstate and a valence bond state. That is a spin chain state, which is built from two side states involving, in the issue two case, just two different, two side states, which have two identical fields inside. is down here. So on top of the overlap, to actually find the one-point function, there's also some field theoretical factor in front, but I will not worry about that. Similarly, if you move on to the issue 2/3 subsector, to compute the one-point function of your operators, you have to calculate the overlap between beta eigenstate and a valence bond state, which is built in this form here. We have some two-side states which involve the three complex scalars, and then we have two-side states involving the two fermionic fields, and they come with a minus in between because of this epsilon alpha beta, which appeared in the contraction rules. So the valence bond states as boundary states, they are relevant if we consider this k=1 case. But I should say that the valence bond states, the two-side product states, they're also important as initial steps when you try to prove overlap formulas for matrix product states. Then you can start from the overlap with a valence bond state and find some transformation that takes that into a matrix product state, and that would help you prove the general overlap formulas. Okay. So let me say a few words about what overlap formulas look like, what we've learned about them from studying them in concrete cases. Well, we know, let me take first the matrix product states. We know that the overlaps with matrix product states, they always involve the Gaudin matrix, or rather its superdeterminant. I will define in a minute what the superdeterminant is, but it always appears in overlap formulas. I can say that the Gaudin determinant itself is a quantity which encodes the norm of a beta eigenstate in this way here. On top of the superdeterminant of the Gaudin matrix, one typically has a prefactor, which is a product of ratios of Baxter polynomials, more precisely reduced Baxter polynomials, which are Baxter polynomials where one excludes possible roots at zero. And then one can have more complicated objects, which are sums of ratios of Baxter polynomials. And for a matrix product state of order k, corresponding to the k's representation, what we typically have is a sum from a to minus k over 2 to k over 2, some representation like a sum. For valence bond states, the overlap formulas, they are in general more simple. They typically don't involve any sums, but just products or ratios of Baxter polynomials. This was conjectured by Potsky some years ago, and he derived various overlap formulas by assuming this simple structure and using some analyticity conditions coming from the TBA to derive some formulas that turned out to be correct. So in the following, I will focus on valence bond states, which are of relevance for the k=1 case of the ADS-DCFT correspondence. And what I want to use them for is to understand the structure of overlap formulas for superspin chains. And in particular, I will investigate how these overlap formulas transform under fermionic dualities. As I have already said, a super Lie algebra, it has several different Dynkin diagrams, and knowing the overlap formula in one for one Dynkin diagram naturally leads to the question of what would it look like in if you were using another Dynkin diagram. Of course, the one-point function of a given operator does not change under the change of Dynkin diagram, but the way in which the operator is represented in terms of a beta eigenstate changes if you change the Dynkin diagram. So this is the kind of complications that I want to shed some light on. Here I've listed some examples of overlap formulas that are known for various valence bond states. So in the SU2 spin chain, the overlap between an arbitrary beta eigenstate and this valence bond state, which is very simple, it's just a combination of two side states with identical fields at each side. The overlap takes this formula here, and now I'm actually writing the overlap squared, because the overlap itself involves a square root, and I don't want to care about that square root. But the overlap formula, it involves this super determinant that I mentioned, and I will explain in a minute. And then it has this simple ratio of Baxter polynomials. If we move on to the SU3 spin chain and consider the analogous valence bond state, which actually should appear to the power L over 2, where L is the length of the chain, then the formula for the overlap is also a simple minimization of the formula for the SU2 case. You see, you have now a product of two Baxter polynomials, both in the numerator and the denominator, corresponding to the fact that for SU3, you have two nodes in the Dynkin diagram. And based on these two examples, one would expect that if one looks at the case corresponding to the Lie algebra with a simple Dynkin diagram with three nodes, then one would get a similar formula just with a product of three Baxter polynomials corresponding to the three nodes. And that is actually what one gets if one considers the valence bond state of the SO6 spin chain. Okay, all of these spin chains, they are of course relevant for the K equals one defect setup in ADS CFT.
What about SU4?
About what?
SU4.
Well, I consider it to be equivalent to this SO6. The only thing I can actually say something about is SO6 formulated in this way.
No, but I mean SU4 defining representation.
I cannot say explicitly. The only result which has been derived is for SO6.
Okay.
But until recently, there were no formulas for super spin chains. But let me now here present the simplest result you can get for a super spin chain, namely if you take the super Lie algebra SU2/1, which has a Dynkin diagram with one fermionic and one bosonic node. And it's a special example of the SU2/3 case I had before, where the valence bond state consists of one term with bosonic excitations and then these two terms with fermionic excitations. And again, one finds, and that's by explicit mainly numerical computations, that the overlap formula takes this form here, again with a super determinant of the Gaudin matrix and some Baxter polynomials in front, in a slightly different combination than what we had before. Okay. And actually, by the recent work of Gombo and Beiner, we also have an expression for the overlap formula for the full PSU2/4 spin chain. That's derived actually for k larger than one, but we can use a small trick to get it for k equals to one, because we have observed that if we analytically continue the k larger than one higher loop formula to k equals to one, then we actually, in the SU2 case, reproduce this formula here. And therefore, we assume that the same is the case for the PSU2/4 spin chain, that if we analytically continue the higher loop result from k larger than one to k equals to one, then we get a correct overlap formula. And if we do that, we get an overlap which looks like this. It corresponds to a Dynkin diagram, which is the so-called alternating grading Dynkin diagram, and has this appearance. Again, the overlap is some combination of Baxter polynomials corresponding to the various nodes. Some Baxter polynomials come with argument 0, and some come with the argument I over 2. And one can, of course, start guessing how this is related to the nature of the nodes in the Dynkin diagram. But it also immediately poses a question, namely, how do we compare this overlap formula to the previously derived overlap formulas, to the one that I just showed you for SU2/1, and the one I also just showed you for SO6, because neither of these Dynkin diagrams we can get by truncating this alternating Dynkin diagram up here. And a closely related question is, of course, what does this overlap formula look like in other gradings, like the beauty grading or the beast that we learned about in the early days of AGS CFT integrability? So this is the kind of questions I would like to answer in the remaining part of the talk. Okay, so first a few words about integrable super spin chains. So if we consider an integral, a super Lie algebra of type DL M times N, then it has a with some particular Dynkin diagram, then it has that is associated with this Dynkin diagram, a Cantan matrix, and some Dynkin labels. And let's say there are N nodes in the Dynkin diagram, then there are N Dynkin labels, and this Cantan matrix is N times N. And in a super Lie algebra, there are bosonic and fermionic nodes. And the Cantan matrix can be chosen to be three diagonal and symmetric. And all possible Dynkin diagram one can get by combining elements of this type up here. So the lines that link the various nodes in the Dynkin diagram, they come in two types, but that has to do with the sign of the diagonal elements and the slightly off diagonal elements in the Cartan matrix. So there's a specific translation from diagrammatic form of the Dynkin diagram to the elements in the Cartan matrix. And having the elements of the Cartan matrix, you can write down the Bethe equation of an integrable nearest neighbor spin chain based on that super Lie algebra. It looks like this. And what I need this for is to define the Gaudin matrix, which appears everywhere. So here there's one Bethe equation for each Bethe root. So there's a set of Bethe roots for each node, and the nodes are labeled by A's, where A runs from one to N. And for each node, there's a certain number of Bethe roots that I denote as KA. So to define the Gaudin matrix, I look at the Bethe equation for the jth root on the eighth node, and then the aj big k's element of the Gaudin matrix is the derivative of this phase here with respect to the root bk. So it's a very huge matrix. It has a size which is equal to the sum of all the numbers of the various excitations times the same number, of course. So it's somehow the Jacobian from the change of variables from the Bethe roots to these phases which appear here in the Bethe equations. Okay. And what can I say about this Gaudin determinant? Well, it's quite constrained if you are interested in integrable, if you're interested in Bethe eigenstates which have an overlap with an integrable boundary state. So the requirement that the boundary state be integrable was that it was annihilated by all the odd charges of the spin chain. And this actually implies that Bethe eigenstate has an overlap with the boundary state only if all the momentum carrying roots are paired. They come in pairs with plus and minus the same rapidity, at least if we exclude singular cases when the roots are at I or two. And this you see simply by sandwiching this Q operator between B and U. And if the momentum carrying roots are paired, then one can see from the Bethe equations that the auxiliary roots will also be paired, possibly up to a single root at zero. And from this pair structure of the Bethe roots, it actually follows that the Gaudin matrix has a block structure. So it can be symbolically written on a block form like this, where actually it's literally like this if you look at the SU2 spin chain. And for such a block matrix, you can find the determinant by performing row and column operations. So you add the second block to the first block, and afterwards you subtract the first block row from the second block row, and you get the determinant you get the matrix on this block diagonal form, and the determinant factorizes into two terms. And these two terms, A plus B and A minus B, we didn't note as D plus and D minus. And the quantity which enter all overlap formulas is the determinant of D plus divided by the determinant of D minus, which we can view as the superdeterminant of this matrix that appears here, viewing these two diagonal blocks as even and the diagonal blocks as odd. So that is what we call the superdeterminant.
But it doesn't look like superdeterminant of original matrix.
No, I don't think you can actually write as a superdeterminant of the original matrix.
Okay.
But this is what I understand as a superdeterminant. And you can always rewrite the Gaudin matrix in this form here, possibly with some slightly more blocks, but there's always this kind of factorization. Okay, so now I come to the fermionic duality, and as I said, it's a change of variables in the Bethe equations which allow you to pass from one Dynkin diagram to another one. And here I have written down what it implies for the simplest case of issue 2/1. I know there are probably some experts present, but I want to take this simple example in somewhat detail. So the Lie algebra has this Dynkin diagram, and there's an associated Cartan matrix. So based on this Cartan matrix, I can write down the Bethe equations. So I can either write them as product over Bethe rules, or I can write them using Baxter polynomials. So here is the one corresponding to the fermionic node, because there are no self interactions between the V's. And here's the one corresponding to the bosonic nodes, which I assume are the nodes which carry momentum or Dynkin label plus one. So the fermionic duality is a change of variables in the Bethe equations, which I do by I multiply this quantity to the other side of the equation, and then I see this difference between the Baxter polynomials as a polynomial of a higher degree, namely degree k1, and it has by construction k2 roots, k2 roots of type v1, which are the fermionic roots, and then there must be k tilde, which is equal to k1 minus k2 plus one, it should be alternative roots vi tilde, which are the dual roots. And now I want to eliminate my original fermionic roots in terms of these, in favor of these dual roots vi. And the first Bethe equation, it remains unchanged because the dual roots fulfill the same relation as original roots, but the other equation changes slightly. And in order to eliminate the Bethe roots v from that equation, I have to massage this relation in a particular way. And I find that the combination of Bethe of Baxter polynomials which enter this equation can exactly be expressed in terms of q2 tilde divided by q2 tilde plus divided by q2 tilde minus, where as usual we have these plus and minuses which signal that we change the argument by plus or minus I or two. So after the duality transformation, my second Bethe equation also becomes fermionic. And it looks like this and corresponds to this Dynkin diagram over here. So my fermionic duality is simply a change of variables in the Bethe equations, where the Bethe roots is associated with the fermionic node become eliminated and replaced by some dual Bethe roots. So it's only one set of roots which get dualized. Okay. So that is one particular case of dualization. Mm-hmm. And
So is it a good place maybe in 5 minutes to stop for a coffee break?
Yes, that will be perfect.
Okay, great.
Just maybe two slides and then we stop.
Okay. Great. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so let me finish this with the simplest SU2/1 case. So I wish to perform this fermionic duality transformation from this Dynkin diagram to this one. So if I start with a situation where I have K1 roots on the first label and the node and K2 roots on the second one, and both are even, then after dualization, I will have an odd number of roots at the second node. And that means that those roots cannot be paired, but must contain a single zero. And for that reason, it's actually nice to rewrite the QQ relation from before in such a way that I factor out this single root at zero and work with reduced vector polynomials that do not involve roots at zero. Now one can play around with this, and one can find out that the superdeterminant of the Gaudin matrix, it changes in this way here under the duality transform. So this is a superdeterminant after the transformation, and this is the one before. And they are related in a nice way in terms of Q functions, vector polynomials. And then there's also some combinatorial effect in front. This is something that we have found numerically, but we also have an analytical proof, which is in good progress. And this formula has very many appealing properties. First of all, it actually holds semi-unshell, which means that we can choose our Bethe rapidities at the first node at random. And as long as this duality relation is fulfilled, then the transformation formula looks like this. It's also potentially a very nice formula, because you see that if my original overlap formula for the first Dynkin diagram involves a Q2 times D, then my dual formula will contain D tilde divided by Q2 tilde. And all dependence on the dualized roots have disappeared as we would like. So we have a nice covariant way of transforming the superdeterminant. And I should say that this factor here, K1, it simply signals that when we change from one Dynkin diagram to another, then a given operator, which is maybe from the beginning is the highest weight state, under a change of Dynkin diagram will not necessarily anymore be a highest weight state. And we know that for non-highest weight states, the overlap formulas typically contain factors like that. Okay, so that is something we would expect. Although we're working out in exactly what combinatorial factor we would expect, I don't know exactly how to do. Okay, so before the break, let me just say something about fermionic dualities. In general, this was a very simple example, but fermionic dualities, they allow you to move between any two Dynkin diagrams of a super Lie algebra of the type we're interested in, at least. And it always involves only a fermionic node and its two neighbors. It's maybe not exactly easy to see right now from the point of view of the Gaudin matrix, which involves all roots and all which are coupled in all possible ways. But due to this particular block form that I described, it's only necessary to look at Dynkin diagrams of length 3 with a fermionic node in the middle. If you do a fermionic duality transformation, then you change the nature of the neighboring nodes in the Dynkin diagram, and you also change the nature of the connections. And there's a nice geometrical representation of that fact, which describes the fermionic duality as a flip across a plaquette. But actually, I will not need this picture for the following, so let me not go into that. Then you also have to worry about whether a dualized mode is momentum carrying or not. So if it's not momentum carrying, then meaning that it has Dynkin label 0, then it will also then no Dynkin labels change anywhere. Whereas if the mode after which you dualize carries momentum, then the Dynkin labels can change under the fermionic duality. But it changes in a relatively simple way. If just the middle node carries a momentum, then the Dynkin labels changes in this way here, where the two different signs correspond to the two different connecting lines in the Dynkin diagram. Okay, I think this is a good time to break. And then after the break, I will try to describe how the fermionic dualities work for such three-node Dynkin diagrams in the most general case.
Okay, thanks.
This is where we were. So I argued to be able to transform from any Dynkin diagram to any other one, I just need to understand how to perform a fermionic duality for a Dynkin diagram consisting of three nodes. And then I have to distinguish between two cases, one where the fermionic node that I dualize after is momentum carrying and one where it's not. So here's a case of a non-momentum carrying node. Then I have a Cartan matrix, which has a zero corresponding to the fermionic root. And then it can have some other elements which depend on whether the neighboring nodes are fermionic or bosonic, or whether these connecting lines are dashed or full. And the Dynkin labels, they are only constrained to have a zero for the fermionic node. And now one has to go through various cases. We say we have KL, KM, and KR roots at the three nodes for left, middle, and right. If they're all even and we dualize after this middle node, then the number of dual roots at this middle node after dualization is equal to this combination. And due to this minus one, it should actually be a plus one, I think, then it has to be odd. Again, then our formula, which allows dualization, the change of variable formula, we write as a Q-cube relation, and we factor out this single root at zero, so that we work only with reduced Baxter polynomials. And again, by numerical experiments, we can find a formula which works for all values of the number of roots and elements of the Cartan matrix. And you see that it has the same structure as before. It involves some combinatorial factor, and then it involves some ratio of Q functions with two in the numerator and two in the denominator. And again, it has a product of a Q function and its dual partner. So it also signals something nice if the original overlap formula depends on Qm via Qm times d, because then the dualized one will depend on Q, the tilde variables as d tilde over Qm tilde. Again, it's only found numerically, but an analytical proof is in progress. Then one can worry what happens if we don't have an even number of roots at the three nodes, but it's, for instance, if the middle node has an odd number of roots. Well, then it actually corresponds to looking at this equation the other way around, starting on the right-hand side. So and that means that we're actually doing the inverse transformation. So in that case, d tilde would be equal to this big prefactor to the minus first times d. And then there's actually an extra minus because the dualization actually changes the value of the elements, of diagonal elements in the Cartan matrix. You can also wonder what happens if one of the neighbors here comes with an odd number of roots, but you can check that the still formula holds, still the same formula holds. So there is an annoying number of possibilities you have to take into account, but the short answer is that this formula here is correct. Okay, so that was non-momentum carrying. A momentum carrying node is a node for which the Dynkin label is different from zero, of course. And again, we consider a case where we have any node to the right and the left and any type of connecting line here, and one can write down completely generally what the Cartan matrix looks like. That's not what differs from the non-momentum carrying case is that the QQ relation that we use to do the change of variables looks slightly different. There's a dependence on the Dynkin label, both on the left-hand side here and on the right-hand side over here, where this coefficient here, it just comes from the fact that we want the Baxter polynomials to have a highest order term with a coefficient of one. again, one can look for the transformation property of the superdeterminant, and we find once more a formula which looks like before. It looks actually exactly as before in what regards the Q functions, but it has some combinatorial factor in front, which is slightly different and which now involves the Dynkin label. That is the case where all the numbers of excitation, all the excitation come in even numbers, and also the length of the spin chain is even. One can wonder about other cases, and here we actually meet a complication if the number of excitations on the left or the right node is odd, then we actually get a singular Gaudin matrix which requires regularization. But once it's regularized then in the correct way, then we get again this formula. I should say that the regularization is not completely trivial, because the regularization requires us to go away from this symmetric setup where all the groups are paired. But in the limit where the regularization is removed, we recover the symmetric pairing of roots. Okay, but this is all I need. I need these two transformation formulas for the momentum carrying case and the non-momentum carrying case. And then I can dualize all the overlap formulas that I want. So here's an example where I want to recover the overlap formula that I found. We found ourselves for SU2/1, which was a formula pertaining to this Dynkin diagram. I want to recover that from the result of Gumbo and Beinock, and that I can do by starting with this three node Dynkin diagram, which is, by the way, a Dynkin diagram for SU2/2. Then I can dualize after the middle node, that brings me to this diagram. And if I dualize once more after the last node, then I get to this Dynkin diagram, which contains the Dynkin diagram that I want as a sub diagram. And then I can simply start from the overlap formula I found for this Dynkin diagram on the left and do first one dualization. So in the first step, I get this Q2, which is the root that I dualize after. I get it removed and replaced by a Q tilde in the denominator. And then I also get these two Qs at the neighboring nodes removed. Yeah, I don't know if you can follow, but then I do another step, and one has to be careful to use the right kind of transformation formula, which corresponds to either an even or odd number of roots at the various levels. But if you do it in the correct way, you get now where you dualize after the third node, you get this Q3 removed in the denominator, and you get it appearing in the numerator. And you get an additional Q2 of I over 2 in the denominator. And then I can compare to my original formula by ignoring this Q function from the third node, capping off the last node of the Dynkin diagram. And it turns out that now I get exactly the overlap formula that I had originally for SU2/1. So there's complete consistency between the results obtained in the various gradings, which is, of course, as it should be. That was one particular example of dualizing an overlap formula. What can one say in general? Well, I said it more or less already, but you always have a transformation formula that looks like that the superdeterminant in one grading is related to the superdeterminant in another grading by some Baxter polynomials of the node that you dualize after in the denominator, and then some Q function for the neighboring nodes in the numerator, or vice versa, depending on which way the transformation goes. So one can represent it graphically in this way here, that if you start from an overlap formula which has a Q function for the dualizing node in the numerator, then after the transformation, then it gets shifted to the denominator, because this factor here kills Q in the numerator, and then it's replaced by another Q of 0 in the denominator. And it adds two additional Q functions in the numerator on the neighboring nodes. And they have an argument which is I over 2, which is represented by this one here. I can also move in the other direction, and then I get a Q function in the denominator replaced by a similar one in the numerator and two additional Q functions in the denominator on the neighboring nodes. So there are some strict rules for how the duality transformation works. And it works nicely only in the case where the fermionic node has this Q function of zero, either in the numerator or in the denominator and in the power one. Because only in that case, I can, by the transformation formula, eliminate all dependence on the dualized roots. And this seems to be, to me, quite constraining, at least for the possible overlap formulas. Okay, this recipe also allows us to get the full overlap formula in the beauty grading, starting from the alternating grading of Gomba on Beiner. So here I have written down the overlap formula in the diagrammatic notation from the paper of Gomba and Beiner. And if I start from that, I can, in two steps, move to the Bethe Dynkin diagram. I dualize first after the two outermost fermionic nodes. That gives me some other combination of Q functions. And in the next step, I dualize after the next two outermost fermionic nodes. And in those two steps, I actually arrive at the Bethe Dynkin diagram or PSF2.2/4. And yes, my overlap formula appears encoding here. And one can in particular check that this formula, it agrees with the formula, overlap formula I presented further earlier for SO6, which corresponds to this middle part of the diagram. So everything is perfectly consistent. And these transformation formulas also put some constraints on the possible overlap formulas.
Oh, sorry, I have a technical question.
Yeah.
Well, mm-hmm. It looks like on the previous side, you said that zero flips from numerator to denominator.
Mm.
Yes, and now if I look at your next slide, it doesn't happen.
Well, it happens sometimes. It depends on whether the number of roots at the dual
line. Just look at the fermionic duality on the left cross. Oh, that was the very first line, right? Yeah, this one. I mean, this result of fermionic duality, right?
From okay, I might have made a mistake here on this, actually. It always has to change. I'm sorry. I think I have not done it properly at the intermediate step, actually. It's true. It should move. If it's in the denominator, in the numerator, it should move to the denominator and vice versa. Yeah, I'm sorry about that. I have simply... Yeah, I have copied something wrong.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry about that. Sorry about that. But it's possible. But duality can flip a Q function from the numerator to the denominator or vice versa. But it depends on the number of roots at the dualizing node. Yeah. Sorry. Okay. Yes, so yeah, what I said until now is all about the fermionic dualities, but we know, of course, that for superspin chains, there exists a much bigger web of dualities, which also involve bosonic dualities. And these bosonic dualities, they can, together with the fermionic dualities, be encoded in the Hasse diagram of the super Lie algebra. And here for this Lie algebra SU2/1, to have the most general form of the QQ relation, one needs 8 Q functions, 2^3, and they can be organized in a pattern like this, where the top one and the bottom one are somehow fixed by boundary conditions. And then every choice of path in this diagram from the bottom node to the top node, it corresponds to a certain choice of Bethe equations. I do not intend to go into this in detail, but the Bethe equations we considered, they correspond to this blue path here. And performing the fermionic duality that I did, it corresponds to flipping this blue path to the red part here, and which it flips this Dynkin diagram to this other red Dynkin diagram with two fermionic nodes. But for my Bethe equations, I could have done an additional symmetry transformation, namely the bosonic duality transformation, where I flip this blue path across this bottom square, and that would replace the Bethe rapidities at the first node by a set of dual Bethe rapidities, and again it would lead to a change of the overlap formula. And it would of course be interesting to understand how the superdeterminant it transforms under the full set of QQ relations, not only the fermionic dualities. That is something that we would like to address in the future, but we have done a small warm-up exercise, namely by considering issue 2, where we have a Hesse diagram with only 4 Q functions and a bosonic duality equation, which is very simple. It involves just one Baxter polynomial and it's dual, and they have to fulfill this relation here. So if my original set of Bethe roots come with a number Q K1, then the dual roots, they have a number which is the length minus K1 plus 1. And I wish to understand how the superdeterminant changes under this change of Bethe rapidities. Here it turns out that no matter, well, we always run into some problems with regularization. Namely, if we start from paired roots in our original node, then there will always be dual roots at plus minus I over 2. Which will cause the Gaudin determinant to be singular. And this one can convince oneself by looking at the constant term in this equation here, which has to be fulfilled. But nevertheless, one can invent a regularization for the Gaudin determinant, which again is a little bit non-trivial because it requires one to go away from the symmetric point and only recover the pairing structure in the limit where the regularization is removed. But at the end of the day, one gets a formula of this type after regularization. So again, it has some combinatorial prefactor in this case, and then some combination of tilted and untilted Q functions, where these Q functions are further reduced, but we have left out both the roots at 0 and the roots at plus minus I over 2. Okay, but we would of course like to go further and to look at the more advanced bosonic dualities one has for the full superalgebra of n equals 4 supernormals. Okay, that brings me close to the end, but the very last thing I wanted to say was a little bit about this proof in progress of the transformation formula. And the key element for the transformation properties of the Gaudin matrix is that it has this block form that I described earlier. More precisely, we can always write it in a form like this, where the two off-diagonal blocks are each other's transpose. So they don't need to be square, but they are each other's transpose. And such a block matrix, one can always factorize in the following way. So you have an upper triangular matrix or an upper diagonal block matrix, and then a lower block, diagonal block matrix, no, not diagonal, a lower block matrix like this. And you can convince yourself that this is true just by multiplying the terms together. And of course, with this factorization of the block matrix, then you also get a corresponding factorization of the determinant. So it becomes the determinant of E and then the determinant of this block in the upper left-hand corner. And this block in the upper left-hand corner is actually known as the Schur complement of the matrix G, and my students, they educated me on the fact that there are actually books written about Schur complements, but we don't need much of the theory about Schur complements, we just need this factorization property of the Gaudin matrix. This factorization property is also the property that allows me to treat the general fermionic dualities by just treating fermionic dualities for a three-node Dynkin diagram, because I can always put the block corresponding to that three-node Dynkin diagram in the lower right-hand corner of my Gaudin matrix and factorize the corresponding determinant out in front. And therefore, I just need to look at the transformation properties of that part of the Gaudin matrix. Okay, so here consider again my issue 2/1 example and this fermionic duality after the second node, which takes me from this Dynkin diagram, oops, to this one. To find the transformation properties of the superdeterminant Gaudin matrix, I have to write down in some detail the Gaudin matrices. And in this case, where I have two types of roots, I split them after elements that involve only one root, both the face and the object after which I differentiate. So we have something which is 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, and 2, 2. But as I said, the Gaudin matrix has this block form where one block is the transpose of the other. This holds both before and after the duality transformation. But after the duality transformation, the Gaudin matrix get an extra row and column because it's extra. It gets a single row and a single column, which corresponds to this single root at zero that appears if I start from paired roots. But what helps us in this case is that whenever you have a fermionic node, you have a diagonal block in the Gaudin matrix because the fermionic rapidity does not interact with rapidities of the same type. And that means that this lower right-hand corner is diagonal and all this big lower right-hand corner is also diagonal. The same is this upper block here because after dualization, both nodes are fermionic. And this is actually very nice because it makes it possible to actually compute this Schur complement because that requires us to invert that matrix in the lower right-hand corner. And that we can do, of course, if it's diagonal. It also allows us to factor the Gaudin determinant in a nice way. And you see that there's another property of the Gaudin matrix for fermionic nodes, namely this G++ in the lower right-hand corner and G minus minus are the same. So when we factor out this determinant here, E in front, and we take the superdeterminant, which is the ratio between determinant G plus and determinant G minus, then all contribution from the determinant of E cancels out. It cancels out completely over here. But in this case here, there will be a small remnant from E00 tilde. So using Schur complements, I get the superdeterminant written in terms of superdeterminants of the Schur complement. And in one case, I get an additional factor resulting from this extra zero root coming out in front. That extra factor is a sum. To move on from here, one needs to know the Gaudin matrix in quite some detail. For instance, this matrix element is a sum, and using the QQ relations and taking some delicate limits, one can actually rewrite as exactly this prefactor we had in our transformation formula. So it means that in order to show this, or prove our original transformation formula, we still need to show that these two superdeterminants are the same. This proof we have not completed 100% yet, but it looks very promising to use a recursive strategy, like the strategy that Kurepin, Slavnov, and others used to prove that the norm of a beta eigenstate can be given in terms of the determinant of the Gaudin matrix. You start by showing it from some basic case with a small matrix, and then you iterate on the size of the matrix and use some analyticity properties when the matrix at the n plus one step is considered as an analytic function of the last eigenvalue or the last rapidity that you made. But that is something I hope that we can report on in the future. Yes, that was basically where we are at the moment. So what we want kind of hope to learn more from this in the future is that maybe we can learn more if we are able to find the transformation properties of the overlap under all the dualities of the Hesse diagram. And then maybe we can constrain the overlap formulas even further. Another thing that we'd like to do is to complete this proof that I just sketched and maybe eventually derive the overlap formula on the basis of the dualities alone. And of course, as somebody also pointed out, it would be nice to see what one can say about higher loops and relate this to the full quantum spectral curve approach. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice talk. So please unmute yourself and let's thank Charlotte. So are there questions?
Hello? About the fermionic dualities you proved, do you use essentially that the distributions of the Bethe roots are even, or this works also for the for general solution of the Bethe equations?
I considered all possible cases, so to say. I mean, the roots have to be paired, or there can be a single root at zero.
Oh, I see. So you use that.
Yeah, I use because otherwise I don't have a non-vanishing overlap. If I don't have the structure of the beta state, then the overlap will be vanishing.
Mm, I see.
And this is because the matrix product state is and the boundary state is annihilated by all the odd charges.
Yes. You're using dualities for the case of the bulk theory.
Sorry?
I was thinking if it's possible to use your formula in for the Bethe ansatz for the bulk theory. I mean, without boundary state. The solutions for the theory which is periodic. I mean the general solutions.
So you want to, yeah, okay, you have the Gaudin matrix and you want to see how it transforms. That's what
yes,
you're saying.
Under these dualities.
Yes, well, I use quite heavily that the roots are paired, yes. I use very much the structure, the block structure of the Gaudin matrix.
I see.
May I ask a question? Mm-hmm. What was the use of the change of the Dynkin diagrams? Couldn't you work with one fixed choice?
Yes, that's true, but in some situations, one diagram is more convenient than the other one. But very specifically, our first motivation was to compare the formulas that we had derived with some formulas that were derived by another group.
Which the other group used another conventions?
Yes, they used this alternating Dynkin diagram.
Which is not the most typical Dynkin diagram. The most used in the representation theories would one or two odd roots, one in the middle or two at the adjacent ends.
Yes.
Everything else is derivable, but why to use it?
Well, it turns out that for any with four superyangmills, this alternating grading is useful for the higher loop solution. And
okay.
And so if you take the simplest example like SU2, how constraining is imposing the covariance of the formula?
Well, it's again the same. You can either have the Q function in the numerator or in the denominator.
Mm-hmm. Q and power with... 1. I see.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So,
it would be interesting to involve also neighboring fermionic nodes to see what happens for general bosonic duality.
Okay, thanks. Are there any more questions?
Charlotte, is there any mileage in trying to start with? So you said the one point function doesn't change. Could I use that to work out how the boundary state has to change, given that I know how the roots change? Or is it just messy and complicated?
Well, in principle, all the information is there, but I think it's
messy. Yeah, you can't sort of effectively look at the. So you the one point function, you know how the closed string state changes under fermionic duality, right? Because you know what happens to all the roots. And so then can I guess how the boundary state has to change in order for the one point function to be the same?
But the boundary state should not change. I don't understand your question.
The C normalization.
Oh, okay, the overlap.
Yeah.
Well, in principle, as I said, all the information is there. But I have not tried to think about it in that way.
Small remark, for beta equations, you wrote them in a form. The way you wrote it, as far as I recall, is true only for rectangular representations. I mean, the source term defined by the Dynkin label is actually not correct when it's non-rectangular representation, as far as I recall. And just be careful when you do duality and start having a lot of non-trivial sources all over the place.
Okay, yes, point taken.
Maybe I have a question. Did you try to write everything in terms of the single, I mean, the first level Q function, something like that? Maybe, I don't know if something gets nice, maybe it's a mess after. Now you always go along one pass, or you could eliminate everything in terms of the lowest level. I don't know if that's.
I didn't really try anything else than what I explained, but.
Maybe, yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I think simply don't know, but that's enough to have only one level, you mean?
Yeah, I think so, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Why would you like to do it? So for example, in SOV, we found that some scalar products for higher rank case, they naturally involve many different queues. Not for super case, of course, for GLN so far.
That's a question for
Ruben. Yes, probably.
I was just wondering. I mean, you can, of course, change around everything. And in the end, you should maybe pick one. I don't know. This is one that is, quite symmetric, maybe. I don't know. It was just a question, too.
No, but it looks actually not that bad because you evaluated at zero. I mean.
Ah, okay, I see.
So, I mean, you've read Q1, I mean, like if you take a Q3 example, it will be Q1 at zero multiplied by Q2 at zero at today notation. So Q2 at zero will be Vronskian of Q1 on Q1 tilde.
Yeah, right. If it's at special at one point.
It will be just Q1 plus times Q1. Tilde minus, basically, right? Because of symmetry of system. So Q1 plus cancels and Q1 tilde minus remains. So maybe it's not that bad the answer when you try to express through single index Q functions. Your SU2 trial of bosonic duality seems to imply that the formula doesn't change, right? I mean,
uh,
I mean, it's implies that Q divided by Q shift multiplied by Gaudin determinant is invariant under bosonic duality. This is what kind of result up to normalization.
Yes, in principle, I'm just a little bit confused about the regularization. Yeah, but I think you are right. Yes. But I think that was compatible with the formula I had, wasn't it? Let me see. Okay, I cannot shift the page right now. It seems correct what you are saying. Of course, there are only two functions involved. Well, I must say that our understanding of the bosonic case is not very elaborate yet. But I think it is possible that you can get the Q functions upside down after the dualization, because it depends on if the number of roots you start from is even or odd. So that for an even, you would have it in one order, and for an odd, you might have it in another order.
Okay, so I suggest let's close the official part, and then we can go on discussing informally. So let's thank Charlotte once again. And so next week we'll have a seminar by Joaquin Turiach about matrix models and JTE gravity.